We have been working in Vidarbha for quite a period now, from the time of our PhD research, both of us. And we were inducted into this area by our guide, Professor R.K. Mohanty. So we are continuing on the work which he has started and which was started by his guide, Professor S.B. Dev. So a lot of things are coming up into the research now. After when we did some field surveys, we have conducted explorations, we carried out a couple of excavations also. And so therefore, some kind of dynamism which we can see in the early Iron Age culture. And then most important is that when we see the Vidarbha region of central India, the present day Nagpur, Wardha, Chandrapur, then Amravati, all these districts of Vidarbha region of Maharashtra, which falls in properly in central India, it has a very well advanced or very well developed early historic urban phenomenon. And this early historic urban phenomenon we can see from around 5th century, 4th century BC. So, it has a very widely studied, widely known early Iron Age culture too. So now there is a lot of dynamism or a lot of interactions and social and cultural processes which are going on in this region, which have led the background, led this region to develop into an urban area, or what we can say, into a statehood. Now, when I use the word statehood, I use this word because we also come across some coinage of Panchmark coinage, which is before the imperial series, that is before the Mauryan series also. And then we also get the Mauryan period imperial series of Panchmark coinage, and also we get city-states coins from Vidarbha. So when we see this, all these things in the 3rd century BC, 2nd century BC, starting from say around 400 BC or so. So there is all this dynamism is not coming all of a sudden, and there is a lot of social and cultural processes which are into vogue before this historical period stepped in. And these, I'm trying to present some of them over here, which we could identify based on our field surveys and also on basis of the settlement pattern and the burial studies which we have conducted over there. So just to give an idea, this is the map of Vidarbha. In India, you can see it is located over here in the central part. And in this, if you can see this region of Nagpur and Wardha and Chandrapur and then Bhandara. So these districts over here, the major river which is draining this area is the Wainganga. And then there is Wardha. And beyond, towards western side is another major river known as the Painganga. Now all these major rivers, they are draining the region of Vidarbha. In this, the Wardha Wainganga region assumes a lot of importance. Why? Because if you can see this Nagpur region, it is being dotted with a lot of sites. And all these sites, though some of them have been listed over here, but there is a huge score of sites, say around more than 70, 75 sites which are yielding burials, which are found from this Nagpur and Wardha district. In Wardha district, there is only two sites which are known, which are having burials. This number 8 over marked over here is Khairwada. That is one site which is yielding burials. Otherwise, all important sites like Naikund, Borgaon, Bhagimari, Mahurjari, Raipur, Hingna, Takalghat and Khapa, all these are from the region of Nagpur. And there are also stone circles sites known from Chandrapur region. When we come to the Bhandara and Gondia region over here, now Bhandara, over this is older map, so it is showing only Bhandara, but now there are two districts, Bhandara and Gondia, in the same region. They were not well studied in the past, I mean to say in the 1970s, in the 1980s, even till the previous decade, not much was known about the early Iron Age phenomenon or early Iron Age nature of the early Iron Age culture over there in those days. So I am just giving this little bit of idea at the background of the early Iron Age culture in Vidarbha. And there were a, if you go to the next slide, so I've just listed these names of people who have carried out some research over there in the past, like Father Hislop, and then Rivet Carnac, Major Pierce, then Carey. There are a lot of these researches which were being going on in Vidarbha right from the 1840s, 45, 47, when the first excursion was carried out, till the present time, and still the research is going on. Now it has brought to us a lot of data about the culture. Now, how the culture has progressed, we can see that we know that the region was till the 1980s or even till the 1990s, mostly the culture was known to have concentrated in the Nagpur and Wardha districts, and to some extent Chandrapur region too. Mostly we know the culture from the majority of burials which were coming over there. And therefore, the nomenclature, megalithic culture of Vidarbha became prominent or became rampant. Why? Because since most of the sites which were known were burial sites, and these burials were found sprawling the landscape. Just to give an idea, this is from Raipur Hingna. Such kind of stone circle types are found spread over the landscape, all over the landscape, in the Nagpur district, in the Wardha district also, even in Chandrapur district to some extent. So we come across the stone circles, and this is the most abundant type which we get in the Vidarbha region. So we so when we look at the early literature, it tells us that stone circle is the only type which was found in the Vidarbha region, and people were mostly mobile in nature. They were pastoral in nature. Why? Because we did not come across settlements. So apart from a few settlements like Takalgat, Khapa, and Naikund, and Bhagimhari, not many settlement sites were known which were in association with the burial sites. Now the idea was that the habitation area or settlement site area should be very somewhere close nearby to the burial sites. And therefore, this terminology like habitation cum burial or settlement cum burial came up in Vidarbha. So they made two distinctions, that burial sites and the settlement cum burial sites. So these two types of sites were known. And then there it happened that in contrast to southern India, only a couple of sites were known in the past which were having dolmens and menhirs. There are only two or three in number. I'll come to that later on in the presentation. And as I told, there was a trend to think that there are not many habitations of the period in the region. So all this trend was there till the till the end of 1980s. Then one major excursion, like the excursion at Adam, excursion at Bhagimhari, and then consequently there was the excursion at Mahurzuri. So all these excursions, they changed the scenario to look towards the early Iron Age culture in Vidarbha. So what happened is, by the time of the 1990s, a new paradigm came up into research, especially by the writings of Professor Mahanty. A new outlook came that though the megalithic burial in Vidarbha is dominated by stone circle type, they have some variety and some internal architecture, some differentiation is there. And this idea came up to his mind because when they were excavating at Bhagimhari, they came across some internal architecture which is not visible on the surface. If you look at the surface over here, you will see that almost all sites in Vidarbha have these kind of stone circles, but there is no internal architecture which is visible on the surface. Internally, there are only cane packed filling with rubble and black soil used towards the base for the burial. So when these excursions were later on carried out, like Raipur and then Bhagimhari, they changed to some extent the idea that there is some internal architecture, though it might not be common to all the burials. So the idea came up that we should excavate the burials and also identify the types, or rather even explore and plot the burials to identify the physical type differentiation. Now, when we look at the southern Indian types, when we see Brahmagiri, when we see site like Chandravalli or Nagarjun Konda, or even when we go to Tamil Nadu, etc., we come across a variety of burials. Even in a site like Hire Bengal, when we see a lot of dolmens. At the site of Mallasandram, we see a lot of dolmens. Somewhere in Brahmagiri, we see a lot of cists. So there are so many these different types which are found in the same area, in the same region. But when it comes to Vidarbha, if there is only the stone circle type is found, then the idea which came up was that most probably the community was more egalitarian, the community was more nomadic in nature. So based on that stone circles, there was not much classification which could be done apart from there is a single row of stone circle or a double row of stone boulders. So after the excavations, when some internal architecture was observed, this was brought out and it was highlighted by in this article in 1993 and then later on 1996 also. And they tried to change the view that it is not an entirely egalitarian community, not a nomadic community. Why? Because there is some difference in the burials also, in some difference in the burial repertoire also. But there is one more important work which came up around this time was of U.S. Murthy also, who brought out that there are some differences in the community which can be seen on the basis of the grave goods which are there in the burials. Now, when later on the excursions like other sites like Mahurjari, then Vihar, etc. were carried out in Vidarbha region, this idea of having some different internal architecture gained, it gained some solid ground. Now, how I'll show you. So these are some classifications made by Professor Mahanty. Now he tried to show that there is a lot of internal architecture which might not be noticeable easily from the surface. Some of it is visible from the surface, but it might have been overlooked in the earlier researches. So he brought about some various types, like there are the canes which are having peripheral boulders, and then sometimes only the cane burials which are not having peripheral boulders. Then there are canes which having peripheral boulders and sometimes having chamber within them. And then there is peripheral boulders and sometimes with a menhir, sometimes without a menhir. Sometimes there are double rows, and then there are cane burials with peripheral boulders which might be having very loose filling and very loose pebbles might be there on the top. So these are some basic types which could be observed from the surface. Then there are sometimes chambers, sometimes multiple chambers are there. And then sometimes there is a cane burial which might be very loose in its appearance. Such kind of burials over here, which we have mentioned as the Kharwada type, they are very easy for getting destroyed because they are just a loose pile of cane. And such kind of Kharwada type is known from the site of Kharwada, but it has also observed in the site of Junapani, which was not observed by B.K. Thapar when he excavated Junapani in 1960s. So such loose peripheral boulders and loose pebble filling is a easy prey to destruction also. So such different internal architectural types were being classified by Mohanty. And there are some photographs of this. This is the loose Kharwada type. You can see the loose filling on the top, picture from Bhagi Mahari. And this is the picture over here, which we can see over here, a small menhir inside the stone circle. And this is when the loose type burials, when they get destroyed, they get this vegetation on them. Whereas the other area is not having a lot of vegetation. Why? Because the burials, if you look at the burial landscape, if you can see in the picture over here in the left inset and the below, it is a barren land. And the barren land having a lot of shrubs, etc. on it and rocky outcrops. So it is not very good for thick vegetation. It is just like a grassland feature over there. But when the burial was being made, a pit was being dug and there is a lot of black soil which is put. So due to precipitation later on, it gives rise to such kind of vegetation over there, deciduous vegetation. And that can help us to even find out some burials which are lost over a period of time. So these loose types, when they get destroyed, there is a lot of vegetation on them. It helps us to locate these burials. So just to show you how the types are. And then if some are excavated, these are from the left one is from Bhagi Mahari, whereas the right one is from Borgaon and the lower one is from Raipur Hingna. Now all these sites are from Nagpur district. So if you see, there is an internal chamber within. So one type which was noticed, now this excavation gave the idea that such kind of features should be noticed on the surface. And therefore, these various types which I showed earlier, line drawings which I showed earlier, they came up because these kind of things were noticed within the excavation. Now, when these internal chambers were found, and then such kind of even boulders were used for making chambers. This is from Raipur, Hirna, where the in this burial there was a horse which was found in this. So this gave the idea that the stone circle type, though it might be dominating to around 70 to 75 sites having only stone circles in Vidarbha, but it is not the type which is ubiquitous because there is some internal architecture. Though it might not be found in all the burials which are excavated, but it is there in some burials. So it gives us the idea that some part of the society was having a different, little bit a different ritual. Now this, if you see the right hand side image on the top over here, this is Borgaon. Now in Borgaon, a stone trough was found. Now this trough is made of sandstone, which is not locally available in the Nagpur region. It is found in the region beyond the Wainganga. Therefore, so this stone trough which is found in Borgaon, it shows us that for following certain rituals, people were even going to a distance of around 50 kilometers, 60, 70 kilometers away from them to get the raw material and to make such kind of cist or such kind of coffins or troughs also. If we see the in the earlier picture also, in this over here, even the menhir which we can see over here, it is made by Gondwana slab. Now Gondwana slab is again a cist formation which is found somewhere around 45 to 50 kilometers, somewhere 25, 30 kilometers away from the proper Nagpur city and Nagpur area where the burials are found. So this kind of interaction was being done by some communities or some part of the society which required these rituals to be followed, even though the stone circle type was the prominent type. So it gives us an idea about this certain different communities present within the entire megalithic fold over here. Now, if you look at all these types over here, which are tabulated over here, just you can see that these, the categories which are very less in number are those which are having menhirs, the type E, the type G, type H, which is having chambers. So they are present to a very smaller extent, not to a larger extent. The larger extent are the types which are with a single peripheral boulder, the type B, the type A, which is having cane filling. So this is the most ubiquitous type that is quite widely found, just to show of one site like Bhagi Mahari. So the internal architecture is not quite common over here. It is found in negligible percentage. You can say around 1%, 2%, not more than that. So there is only a certain part of the community, 1 to 2%, 3%, which is trying to show its presence by following certain ritualistic disposal of dead, some physical types, which are little bit different from the widely practiced in the Nagpur, Wardha, Chandrapur region. Now, so all these internal, I just talked about the internal architecture right now. Now, certain study was being carried out by myself to understand the, apart from internal architecture, what is the difference which we can see in the grave goods over here. Grave goods were being plotted and the clusters were being made out. Now, grave goods taken into consideration include the iron objects like offensive equipments like spears and daggers and arrowheads, then the carpentry tools like chisels, adzes, then the nail parers, then we have the battle axes, then we have the axes for wood cutting, then we also come across horse ornaments, horse equipments, horse bits, and then ornaments like the beads of same precious stone, gold, and sometimes ritualistic offerings also are there. So all these, when we take them into consideration, we see that there all these sites, they make certain clusters. The burials from various sites are forming groups together to show that there is some common features between them across the sites. So across the site, if you look, we see that there are the principal component analysis shows us that there is a lot of clustering which goes with wherein some burials they go away from the other group of burials. Now in these clusters, it could be seen over here that mostly the craftsman kind of tools like the chisels, the edges, the nail parers were creating a lot of the factor of differentiation. Even the factor which was creating differentiation was the offensive, like the weaponry, etc., which we find over here. So it shows that though the stone circle type is quite common, wherein we only see the stone circles which are there, which where we don't see a lot of internal architecture in the form of chambers and sometimes solitary menhirs can be seen within the stone circle, but to a negligible percentage. But in that case, there is a lot of variation which can be seen within the burials on the basis of grave goods. So all these clusters, they show that on the basis of grave goods, on the presence of the horse equipment, on the presence of weaponry and the carpentry tools or the smithery tools, they definitely form certain social groups within them, which we cannot make out from the physical types only, because we only come across stone circles over there. So it shows us that, just I would like to go a couple of slides back again. So it shows us that the entire region over here in the map, which shows also the Nagpur, Wardhak and this Chandrapur region over here, all these burials, they have some different groups present within them, which can be identified on the basis of their grave goods and to a very few extent on the basis of their internal architecture. So when grave goods become so important, it shows that the community is becoming more and more divided horizontally and vertically both ways. Why? Because the grave goods like the semi-precious stone beads or the gold artifacts, which is not being manufactured for everybody in the community, it is like an exotic item. And this exotic item comes in the case of only a couple of burials. Then that shows that there is a certain vertical hierarchy within the community. Whereas when we see that there are different clusters which are formed, but the factors which are leading to these clusters are only two types of objects, mainly the craftsman tools and then the weaponry. When we see that, then that means that within the craftsman community or within the community which is taking resort to defensive strategies or horse riding and such other activities, within them there is some horizontal distribution. There is some horizontal distinction. Now that horizontal distinction could be seen in these clusters which identified over here, because there are some craftsmen. The clusters definitely tell us that they are involved into making the objects which are, or rather the goods which are related to offensive activities, defensive activities, like the smiths over there. There are some craftsmen which are involved into bead making. There are some craftsmen which are involved into carpentry, making carts and carriages and other things. And some of them which are simple craftsmen like the potters, etc. So this certain distinction could be seen within the craftsmen. So that is some kind of horizontal distinction also which can be seen. So if the community is becoming both horizontal and vertically hierarchic, vertically hierarchical and horizontally distributed, that means there is certain complexity which is coming in. Now when we come to the next point is that there is some aspect which was relatively unstudied earlier. There were a few types like dolmens which were known from a site like Tilota Khedi, Pimpalgaon, which the ASI had reported long back in the report of the annual report of the Archaeological Survey of India. Other than that, some couple of sites like Nagbhid and Pachkhidi were known to have these menhirs present over there. Now, these types are not relatively well known from Vidarbha. So dolmens, menhirs, and then cyst or chambers are not relatively well known. So I already told that referred to a said that these types are almost absent. But it will be very astonishing that to know that in the Chandrapur Gazetteer, there are these certain types which are mentioned in the Shankarpur region. And out of that, which are being mentioned in the Shankarpur region or in the Chimur region, one site was excavated also by Kanti Pawar, known as the site of Hirapur. So, when we see this is the dolmen from Tilotakhedi, and then this is the menhir from Nagbhid. But then Virag, who is the second author of this presentation, he, I'll go to those part first, he carried out a very detailed survey of the Gondia region and he reported 14 new sites. So, 10 burial sites were found, and these out of which many sites, like 5 sites had menhirs and then 2 sites had dolmens in them, and also there was an unknown type which was not known in Vidarbha, is the burial with the capstone. So these types which were reported by Dr. Sontakke, they also gave a new paradigm that these kind of burials or these physical types are also present in Vidarbha, and we have not been able to take them into the in our consideration of academic writing just because they were not known earlier. So therefore, all these interesting evidences were brought forward by Virag, like the cyst, the multiple cyst, and there are central chambers also with the stone rubble is there in the central central part of it. This is a dolmen from Mali, where Virag has excavated in the year 2011-2013. And then this is also, if we see over here, this is a chamber within the stone circle, this has a capstone. Now, interestingly, in this region of Gondia and Bhandara, over here, we see that the stone circles invariably have certain internal architecture in them. Whereas in the region of Nagpur and Wardha, the stone circles don't have internal architectural as a common part. It comes over there, but it is very negligible. I showed you the slide where the percentage of that the types with internal architecture is not more than 2-3%. But in the like this is the just a representative image of Mali, but in this region, whatever sites which Virag has reported, all of them almost have the stone circles have within them certain chambers with capstones. And then menhirs. Now this is from the site of Mali, but other sites like Chilli and Wadega, all other area around Mali and the Gondia district, Bhandara district, they all in the easternmost part of Maharashtra region, state, they have these menhirs present over there. And it is not only solitary examples, but they are in larger number. Recently, there was a survey carried out by one Amit Bhagat also, and he has also reported menhirs and dolmens in the present day Chandrapur district in near Nagbhid. So this site of Nagbhid, he surveyed the area around it and he has brought up sites which have given these evidences. Now we see that these types are coming up, but they are coming up in a certain different ecological zone in Vidarbha. So when we see these types coming up, like the chambers with the capstones, then multiple chambers within them, why I'm saying is they are coming in a different ecological zone is because recently when we surveyed some sites in Bhandara also, we came across the site of Sasra, Katangdhara. Over there also we came across the menhir, we saw, came across sites burial with capstone. So these types are found only in this part and not coming up towards the western part of the Nagpur and Wardha region. So, therefore, what I'm trying to tell you over here is that all these burials over here in this region, they have internal architecture like cysts, chambers, sometimes, and there are a lot of menhirs present over here, which is not fairly represented in the Nagpur and Wardha region. So the picture which emerges is that in the Nagpur and Wardha region there and in the region which is towards the east of the Wainganga, there is certain differentiation within the physical types. Now, what are the reasons for it? I'll just come to it. Before that, I would like to explain one more aspect about Vidarbha. Another aspect is about the early iron age habitations. Now, some habitation sites were known in the past, like Kaunindapur, Pawnar, and then some of them also increased, the number also increased with sites like Tarsa, Arni, Adam, Pawni. But they were again divided into two groups. One is the site which is having a megalithic burial site near it, that is the habitation cum burial, and the other is only early iron age habitation. Now, what happens is that when we look into the site of Mahurjari, it is also coming into the category of having the habitation and the burial close by. Whereas all these other sites which I just mentioned, Kaunindapur, Pawnar, Arni, Adam, Pawni, they all are sites which are having only habitation remains, whereas burials are somewhere near in the vicinity, but not very close to the habitation site. Therefore, the line of thinking always was that these are a different entity altogether. Now, when we come up to the recent research, we could trace somewhere around the more than 20 habitation sites of the early Iron Age. Now, all these combined by, when I'm saying we, I mean to say myself and Virag. So, we could see that these habitation sites where there are not many burials in the vicinity, or the burials are somewhere in the area, in the region of 1 to 2 kilometers from these sites, they should not be called as separate entity. They are part of this homogeneous culture itself, but somewhere or the other, the burial sites are located a little bit far away and not in the immediate vicinity of these habitation sites. So, site of Adam, when we look at the site of Adam, not more than 1 kilometer from Adam, there are sites which are having stone circles in Kuhi, Kopri, etc. Then, when we look at the site of Pawni, very close to Pawni also there are sites which are yielding burials. So, but certainly there are some areas or some habitation sites which are becoming prominent, and they are becoming more and more prominent, and whereas the sites which are having the early Iron Age deposit or the habitation site along with the burial, they are remaining in their own size or in their own shape and not increasing. Now what happens is, when we look at the sites like Adam, Kaunindapur, Pawnar, Pawni, when we look their early Iron Age past, they are very huge sites in their nature. But when they come to the early historic period, they become big cities. Now, whereas when we look at the habitation, when we look at other sites like Bhagemahari, Mahurjari, or Khairwada, where we have the habitation as well as the burials of these early Iron Age period, they remain in the similar rural context even in the early historic period. Now, that means a certain area or a certain resource zone is being selected by the early Iron Age people, the early Iron Age community, and that the sites which are located in that zone, that region, are becoming more and more prominent, or they are becoming more and more prominent and trying to go towards the urbanization. So, just to show you, this is the site of, this is the map of Nagpur region. Over here, you can see all these black dots showing the burial sites, whereas all these red dots are showing the habitation sites. And all these are coming towards the eastern part, that is towards the Wainganga basin. So, the area which is close to the major river like Wainganga and its immediate drainage, or like tributaries like the river of Kanhan, or even we have the Waghora and other small rivers over there, they are being selected, they are being utilized for setting up these habitation areas, or they are becoming prominent as habitation areas. Whereas in the close vicinity, you can see burial sites are located. They are not very far away from them, but there is a definite attitude to occupy more and more fertile zones. Similarly, if you look at this Wardha district over here, you can see the site of Kaundinyapur and other sites which are being marked over here are all habitation sites. They are all coming up close to these river banks, and they are becoming prominent in the early historic period. So, resource zone of agricultural is being used or being considered more important. And then, whereas when we look at the sites, other important sites, if you can see over here, which are being marked in green color, they are the sites which are having habitations and burials both present in them. Both present associated with them. They are located in certain resource zones, like where there is iron ore, or where there is raw material for beads, or where there is a lot of timber available. So these settlement sites are continuing, but they are continuing in the same place, just trying to occupy the resource zone and continuing the occupation of this resource zone. They are not trying to, the area is not very conducive for them to become more and more dynamic in, or rather becoming complex for trying to become a city in early historic period. So, but all these burials which are located all around, they give the picture which I told you earlier of the community which is having a hierarchy in it. A lot of craftsman community is being represented. The community which is having a lot of offensive weaponry, it is being represented over there. And agricultural community is being represented in the burials, which shows this dynamics which is going on within the agricultural community, the craftsman community, to trying to show their status and prestige in the society through the burials, and trying to remain associated with their own settlements which are there from the past. But a certain part of the community was definitely moving and going and occupying resource zones which are more fertile in nature and trying to become more and more agriculturally dominant. So all these, if you see all these sites which are compiled over here, which show us, these are all showing rich raw material like resources around favorable groundwater and alluvium present all around them, which is very useful for cultivation and expansion of agriculture. The agriculture is becoming very important, and that is why if we see the ecological zones, these are the two ecological zones over here. This is the eastern part of Vidarbha region, and this is this Nagpur region, Wardha region over here. We can see that from this area where the cursor is right now, from over here, the alluvium deposits start increasing, and also we start getting the Archean formations. And therefore, in these Archean formations, we see these different burial types coming up. Like there is this presence of menhirs, dolmens, schist with the capstones, etc. And all these Archean formations, Gondwana formations, they are present in this Bhandara Gondia region too. So it shows us that these raw material zones are playing very important role in the selection of burial practices too. Then the question arises that why is the community trying to show itself too much the prestige and the social status from the burial departure in the form of grave goods? Whereas over here in the eastern part, where I showed you the sites like Mali and others which are expected by Virag, where we get a lot of internal architecture, but we don't come across such rich repertoire of grave goods. Even the dolmens which are over there, and excursions at Pachkedi where the manhirs were there, not very rich burial repertoire is found. So where the grave goods are not becoming very prominent, but the physical types are becoming more and more prominent. Whereas in the region where there is Deccan trap is found, we see that there is the physical types are not gaining a lot of prominence, but the grave goods are getting a lot of prominence. So which shows that the community which is there on the eastern part of Vidarbha, that is the present day Bhandara district, Gondia district, Garchul district, it is, and even Chandrapur district, it is more ritually bound and trying to show their differences which are there in the community on the basis of rituals, whereas the community which is there in the Nagpur, Wardha and this western part of Vidarbha region, it is more and more following the social status and other paradigms, and ritual is becoming ubiquitous in nature. It is not ritually, they are not much different, but there are more and more differences there in the basis of their social status. So these things which we can see very clearly. So if we look at this the together map of Vidarbha region only over here, in this we can see this is the region where we get the stone circle types. A lot of stone circles are there, and everywhere we come across only stone circles over here with few internal architecture. Then this is the where the arrows you can see over here. These are the region. This is the region where we come across sites which are yielding only habitational remains, and the entire alluvium fertile zone can be seen. And from and this where Wainganga is, river is flowing on the east of it or to the right hand side, the Gondwana formations are seen. Over there we come across where the purple lines are there. We come across these types of the cyst burials with having cyst within them, the burials with chamber within them, and a lot of menhirs sites, a lot of sites yielding menhirs in greater number. So all this, if we look properly in this map over here, we can see that there is a community over here which is ritually more bound, trying to show the physical types variations within them, trying to follow them, employing people employing people to create these different ritualistic physical types. Are people are employed, which definitely required a lot of labor, whereas on this part where the Wardha Wainganga divide, you can see over here in the Nagpur, Wardha and all this region over here, all the sites, important sites, are yielding a ubiquitous type stone circle in larger number, but having lot of grave good differentiation within them. So the employment of people for the burial rituals is for different purposes. In one place it is for the differentiation in physical types, whereas in other places it is for differentiation within the burial grave goods. And it shows that status and prestige is becoming more symbolic in nature in these stone circle types, and that is because most probably wealth is getting concentrated in their hands. Now when I'm saying this, is it is because we come across gold, etched carnelian beads and lot of iron objects, whereas when we see the sites which are yielding iron smelting, it is only one site known as Naikud over here. Whereas when we come to this region in the Bhandara Gondia area, there are lot of iron ore deposits found, and sites also which are explored and reported where iron smelting was found. Even at Mali there are evidences of iron smelting. So the iron smelting community, the community which was having a lot of resource zones with like iron ore, coal, etc., is not trying to show their social persona in the form of status and prestige, but in the form of rituals it is being more. Whereas the community which is not controlling too much of resources, like they are not controlling too many iron ore deposits, they are not having too agricultural land with them, but they are having still they are trying to show their social persona in the form of social status and prestige, which we can see in the stone circles over here. So it shows that within the region there are so many internal dynamics within the society, and the area which is having a fertile zone which is somewhere or the other falling between these two zones, over there all the habitation sites are major habitation sites are located, which develop further into an urban center. To name a few, like Adam, Pauni, and over here also on this verge on the western side where it comes on the marginal area, there is site like Kaundinyapur. So these sites are becoming important and trying to control both these resource zones. They are trying to control the community, like craftsman community, iron using smithery community, and also the people who are involved into iron smelting, iron ores, iron supply, and also coal and manganese and other raw material for beads. When all these things are coming into force, the area which is controlling them in between is this fertile agricultural zone, which is developing into an urban area. And we see all urban centers coming up over there. Now, this idea, which we could see through the past field works and through our surveys, when we excavated the site of Nagardhan, myself, Virak Sontakke, myself and Srikant Ganvir from our Deccan College and State Department of Archaeology of Maharashtra. So even at the site of Nagardhan also, we came across these lower iron age deposits of habitational in nature, where the iron age settlement was smaller. And then you can see over here, followed succeeded by the 4th, 3rd century BC early historic deposits. And there is a gradual development. So this is the nature which can be seen of urban centers developing in this area. And Nagardhan also falls in this same zone over here, where the cursor is being shown right now. So what I'm trying to tell you over is that this internal dynamic, which can be seen through the internal architecture, the rituals which can be seen through internal architecture, as well as the interaction which can be seen through the grave goods, is the entire internal dynamic which I want to try to highlight over here. So this is just to show some ceramic from Nagardhan. So what some points which I would like to highlight is that whether there were two different heterogeneous ritual groups, then was this the place where these heterogeneous ritual groups, they met together and led to this urbanization, where these heterogeneous ritual groups, some of them either having craft specialization, some of them having control over resource zones like raw materials. Then probably the region to the west of Wainganga, I told you that it was comprising of heterogeneous groups, which is seen from the burial offerings. And settlements are more and more landscape is being used by settlements to utilize the resources. And whereas the region to the east, which I told you, which I showed in those purple circles over there, it was having more ritualistic differences, and the status and prestige is not becoming more important. So therefore, we see that the area which is in the core zone of this entire both these resource zones, it's becoming prominent with major centers like Adam, Pauni, etc. And then, as I told recently, our experience at Nagardhan also strengthened this idea and showed this gradual development. So thank you.